Okay, go.
Okay, so the title of my presentation is called Beyond the Breadboard. Okay, so the reason is because I use the Intel Edison in my company's product, so I'd like to share my experience in using the Edison. Okay. So I work for this kind of startup called Algo Access. So this is what we do, we add IoT capability to those optical machines, the machines that measure eyesight. So this machine on the here, right, this one, yeah, measure eyesight. The data is output through a serial port. So my Intel Edison board actually captures this via a serial port. Then our board also supports the images, so this goes through the USB port here. So everything is transferred via BLE or Wi-Fi to iPad. So that's what my company does. Okay. So for the agenda, I'll first begin with the basics of Intel Edison. This is for those who have no idea what Intel Edison is. Then I'll share about hardware and software experience. Okay, so what exactly is an Intel Edison? So Intel Edison actually is this board over here, just slightly larger than a $1 coin. So you can see here, right? It's actually very tiny. Okay, it's not working. Okay, so this is very tiny, just a 35 by 35 mm. There's no HDMI port, USB port, and so on. Everything goes through that this tiny connector. It's called Hero 70 pin connector there. Yeah, so a more accurate term for Intel Edison is called a system or module, rather than a single board computer. So people like to compare the specifications, so I'll just compare it to the Raspberry Pi 3. The Intel Edison uses an x86 architecture, which is different compared to most single-board computers we use ARM. The unique thing about the Intel Edison is it also has an on-board microcontroller. So if you need to do some real-time stuff, yeah, you can use that. It has no GPU, RAM, the same 1 gig. It has a 4 gig of on-board storage. It has dual band Wi-Fi, which means it has 2.4 and 5 GHz. But based on my experience, right, the 5 GHz chip there is not so stable compared to the 2.4 GHz part. Logic levels, the GPIO bank, right, uses 1.8 volts, so I'll come to that in a moment. Power consumption is much less compared to Raspberry Pi, but this has to be seen in the context that it doesn't have a lot of peripherals, the USB hub and so on. Okay. So there are actually two models of the Intel Edison. So the difference between the two models are actually here, in the yellow rectangle. One has a chip antenna, the other one does not have. Okay, so the chip antenna, okay, let me show you. Okay, so this is actually the data sheet provided by Intel. The difference is that one of them is meant for an internal antenna usage. The other one, does not have a chip antenna, right? You need to plug an external antenna in. Okay, so there's the warning here. See, the internal antenna version has an antenna connector, but you should not use it. Yeah, so this is a warning there by Intel. Okay, so an Intel Edison module cannot be used as is. You require a carrier board. So Intel actually provides two official boards. The first one is the mini breakout board, the small one. So this one has a USB connections and some GPIO pins. You can see this at the back. I think I just pass around. Yeah. Yeah, this is the one. Okay, so this is directly break out of the Intel Edison module, 1.8 volts. The other one is the Arduino breakout board, which the name suggests. It has a form factor of Arduino pinouts, you can see. It has USB port, micro SD slots, DC jack, and the logic levels of the pins are actually level shifted. So you have a choice between 3.3 or 5 volts. The choice is selected by the jumper, J9, which is actually in the red rectangle over there. So just set a jumper and you can get the logic level you want. Okay, there's a third party board by SparkFun. So this is the base block. You can attach Intel Edison there. Then they also provide other stackable boards like the OLED, the GPIO, the IU, National Measurement Unit, 2H bridge for motors, and the battery board. So you can just buy all of these and then you can just stack them up like that. So you can just, yeah, for the beginners, I actually would recommend this over the official Intel box. Okay. So now I go on to the hardware portion. Because in my company, I had to design a PCB for the Intel Edison, but there's actually no proper breakout boards available, so I had to first design my own breakout board for Intel Edison. So it's here. So I just pass the samples here. Just pass it. So here you can see this is the Hero's connector. I break out every single pin into the true hole form. So I've open sourced this design. So you can just, yeah, if you need to, you just download it and fabricate it. So, yeah, I want to say that because the connector is so small, 0.4 mm pitch is very tough to solder by hand. So 0.4 mm pitch means that the distance from one center of one pin to the center of the other pin is 0.4 mm. The pins are actually only 0.2 millimeters apart. It's very difficult to solder with a naked eye. So I actually recommend you to use a USB microscope or something like that to actually solder. And best of to be sure they solder properly, actually I would recommend they use a stencil. Don't try to solder by hand. You get a lot of solder bridges, a lot of failures. Yeah, so this is my company's board. Before I designed the PCB, I prototyped it up on the brain board. Yeah, so now I'll come to the logic levels. But so Nintendo Nissan uses 1.8 volts. Most boards actually use 3.3. Most chips and boards use 3.3 and 5 volts. So, okay, the chip I'm using here, right, because I have a serial board, I need to use a TTL converter. This chip operates at 3.3 volt logic levels. So in order to reconcile them, right, you need a level shifter. So in this case, the shifter I use is by Texas Instruments. The shifter will require a reference voltage. So Intel has provided in one of the pins over there, pin number 12, the 1.8 reference voltage for you to use. Okay. Yeah, for LEDs, you can just use a transistor. No, not so important. Then there's actually a bug in the GPIO 48. Okay, so I'll just talk about this. So this is the pinout. GPIO 48 is here. Pin 32. So what is the problem? Okay, before I go to that, there are actually alternative namings. So it's called GP48, Compute Module Pin 32, Arduino Pin 7. These are all the, basically all refer to the same thing. Okay, so this MRAA documentation actually lists this thing out. MRAA is actually the C library provided by Intel for you to interface with the GPIO pins. So one of the lines here, they say, Arduino pin 7 can sometimes negatively impact the Wi-Fi capability if using Wi-Fi avoid using this pin. The strange thing is that this is not in the MRAA, it's not even the official documentation, you know. So unless you happen to see the MRAA documentation, you see this line over there. So yeah, so what does it mean? So all of these boards are affected. GP48, right, is out here. I pointed it out there already. So it's Arduino pin 7 and the breakout box. The mini breakout board is actually the J19. J19 is the third row from the top and 6 pin from the right over there. So all these pins are affected by this bug. It's a hardware bug. So just basically avoid using them. Okay. USB on the go. So just now, Basu talked a bit about that. So there's also a USB on the go feature on the Intel Edison. Okay, so there's host mode, client mode. So host mode means that Intel Edison acts as a host. You can connect things like a thumb drive to it. A client mode is used for loading firmware. Because in order to load the initial firmware, you need to plug the Intel Edison to your computer. So DFU means device firmware update mode. Okay, so it's a USB OTG, it can support both host and client. So how do they do it? So actually there are some pins here. The selection is actually done in hardware, not software. So in the Arduino board, you can see the red arrow there. This is where you will select which mode you want the Intel Edison to be. So in my own board, I design also done the same thing. I have a selector switch there. So this is actually how you do. So to select between host and client, right, I would recommend using something called the double pole double throw switch to select between two. One switch can control two circuits. So to get from a host mode, to get the host mode, you connect the USB ID to ground and the source 5 volts to USB A power. And for the client, it's the other way, ground to 4 and USB A power to USB V bus. Okay, I have a laser pointer here. Okay. Okay. What was it? Okay.
Yeah.
So host mode, okay, I got it, it's good. So the host mode, right, okay, so host, right, you connect this and this. Then the client is this and this, okay? So the power, you can see, is being redirected. So in host mode, you direct the power from here to here. This is a power source for my board, here. So for it to be client, is from here to here. Okay, why are these slides? Because the official Intel documentation is not very clear about this. So this is the data sheet that they give. I read this back and forth and I still don't understand clearly. I still have to do trial and error to understand this portion here. So yeah, that's why I created this slide here to explain this issue. Okay, now I'll come to the software part. So there are actually two main Linux distributions. The first one is the Yocto, second one is UBLinux. The first one is default, provided by Intel, supported by Intel. the problem is this, that this is actually very difficult for during development process. Like, you need to compile everything. Then the basic package manager OPKG is actually very little. For example, you have you don't have nano, you start with VI. As a text editor, it's like very difficult to use.
Emacs.
They don't have Emacs also. Okay, so that's why some people, they actually, another company called Immutex Labs, they created this, another one, UB Linux, based on Debian. But the problem is this Debian is based on Debian BZ, which is an outdated one. The newer one is called Debian Jesse. But the thing is, it's using apt-get, so you still have access to a lot of packages compared to Yocto. The third alternative is you compile your own. You can compile Yocto or I'll come to that. Well, another problem with the kernel version on the database is very old. It's 3.10.17, which was released in October 2013. It's not been updated yet. So if you have any requirement for a newer kernel feature, you might want to stay away from Edison first until Intel has releases a new kernel. Yeah.
Says the man with the t-shirt.
Firstly, okay, yeah, this is another problem. Poor default support for USB Ethernet and USB Serial. Out of the box, the firmware given by Intel, right, the kernel only supports this Ethernet adapter and this Serial adapter, no others. So if you want to have others, right, you actually need to recompile the kernel. So this is an example. If you have recompiled the kernel before, you probably see something like that. You basically select what features you want in your kernel. Yeah, so you need to manually toggle them and recompile it.
Your kernel is 3.14.
Ah, yeah, I know. Yes, correct. So for some reason, right, yes, it's written here 3.14. When I compile out, it comes back 3.10. I don't know why. Okay, another issue is that the small partition size. So by default, right, this is the partition layout. Here, default is available to 5.1 meg on the root directory. Then this, the home directory is given this 1.3 gigs. Yeah, so it's very small. So if you want to, if you actually need to install a lot of things, right, this may not be enough. Then, too small. So actually, you can modify, but you need to recompile the entire thing. So you need to request recompilation. Okay. So actually, I've actually written the compilation script. I open source the script. So what my script does is actually, you download the entire source code, kernel source code, make the necessary modification to include all the available USB Ethernet serial drivers and adjust the root FS size. So you can just download this script and then you can just use it. Okay, lengthy compilation time. Yeah, so it takes 4 to 6 hours to compile the entire kernel plus all the extra stuff. Yeah, so if let's say you want to do try and error, you have to modify one kernel option, yeah, then compile again. Then wait another 4 to 6 hours before you can try another option. Yeah, so at first I did that, then I couldn't take it already. So I decided to use the cloud. So here, right, you can use Google Compute Engine or AWS to help you. So here, for example, I set with 32 CPUs. So it reduced the time to about half an hour. A lot faster. This is
expensive.
Yeah, it's not free. Definitely, it comes at a cost. Okay, so I just show you, right. So you see the compilation process, 32 step threads at one go. Yeah, much faster.
It's way too much to pay.
It says $634 per month. How much do you approximately spend just to
compile? One compiling will take a few dollars. Okay, I'll come to that. So you see, okay, so remember to shut down the instance. This is if you don't shut down the instance, right? You leave it running, right? You will really charge you at all. So be careful. The moment you. Yeah. So just basically be careful. The moment you want to ready to compile, start the instance, run what you have to do. After that, pull SSH down or FTP down, they could stop the instance. If not, it will charge you like crazy. Okay, so system safety. Don't want me to, okay, can. So this is actually an issue for if your commercial products are. You cannot tell people that please shut down your internet system properly. Yeah, so there are actually two ways. You need to set a read-only file system. Or if you need to write something to the file system, right, you need to protect it by doing something called full journaling. Okay, so this is the appstat file. Appstat file, for those who don't know, right, is a configuration file to tell Linux how to mount your partitions with what options. So I just said RO means read only. So when everything is read only, right, there's no chance of file system will get corrupted. But if you need to write to the file system, right, there's an alternative. You mount it to journal everything. So you set this option, just run these commands and set like that. data journal, everything, and commit changes to these two, not even cache it. Because if you cache, right, if let's say your intelligence shuts down, right, you will lose your cache data. So you don't want that. Yeah, it will affect your disk performance, but never mind. At least data safety. Okay, so yeah, that should be all. Yeah, any questions? Well, anyone? No more son?
Yes, sir.
Okay, never mind. Later. I'll answer it after everything else. Okay?